today's video, I'll introduce you to this interesting concept known as elementary modes which exist in metabolic networks. We'll look at the definitions and then we'll also look at a couple of simple examples to understand the concept of elementary modes as well as extreme pathways. We'll now look at another concept which is that of elementary modes, which are fundamental properties of metabolic networks, and let's see how they are useful in making different conclusions about metabolic networks. So, what is an elementary mode? So, an elementary mode is a minimal set of enzymes that can operate in steady state with all irreversible reactions proceeding in the appropriate direction. Right? Reversible directions can obviously go either way, but irreversible reactions, all of them should be proceeding in the correct direction, and this is a minimal set of enzymes. So, all flux distributions in the living cell are some non-negative linear combinations of the fundamental elementary modes. So, this also tries to go back to the together with another concept that we will see shortly, to go back to this concept, right? You have a flux space, so you have some flux cone, right? So, can you characterize, you can think of characterizing every point in the cone based on some fundamental fluxes. So, any vector in a space can be written in terms of its basis vectors. So, if you had the basis vector for this entire cone, any valid flux distribution can be written in terms of those basis vectors and so on. This is a related concept. This is what we will see in the immediate next slide. So in fact, it's on the left null space of the stoichiometric matrix.
Okay.
Right. So you are saying SV equal to 0, right? So also these are all the V's that satisfy SV equal to 0. Of course, all the other conditions as well. Right. So it is a part of the space of all possible flux solutions. So, elementary modes are basically derived from the stoichiometric matrix directly, but they are computationally very expensive to compute. Right? What are the properties of the EFMs? First is, there is a unique set of elementary modes for a given network, and each EFM consists of the minimum number of reactions it needs to exist in steady state as a functional unit. Right? If you remove, by definition therefore, if you remove any reaction from an EFM, the elementary mode cannot operate. So, it's a sort of chain of reactions which, so you can think of any cell to be some combination of EFMs. So, you can think of, this is for anything. So, we will actually look at an example. Let us just hold on to that. So, an EF and you know, so there is some notion of genetic independence, right, and non-decomposability. You can't break down an EFM into anything smaller, and they are also genetically independent, meaning like, you know, there are different genes in different EFMs and so on, right. And EFMs are the set of all routes through a metabolic network which are consistent with the above property. There is also this other concept of extreme pathway. This is mathematically easier to understand in some sense. They are derived from the stoichiometric matrix similar to EFMs. There is a unique set of EPs for a given network. Each extreme pathway again consists of the minimum number of reactions it needs to exist as a functional unit, and they are the systematically independent subset of EFMs. No extreme pathway can be represented as a non-linear, non-negative linear combination of the EFMs. So, these are basically basis vectors of the flux space, right. So, a third way to look at it is, there is an operational definition. So, start from a given metabolic system, you keep blocking an enzyme with addition of, you keep turning off an enzyme one by one, and if there is still some flux going through the system, you keep blocking an enzyme and so on. An elementary mode is reached when the inhibition of any other enzyme will lead to complete cessation of steady state flux in the system.
So, okay. Entire V vector should be 0.
It will become 0 if, but this is not with a specific objective function if you see, right. This is just to, so if you go back to the example of pipes that we were talking about, this is just one series of pipes that can independently carry water. It is not dependent on any other pipe. The genetic independence criterion that we were talking about. Minimal genome has a goal, right? Here there is no goal as such. Here the goal is just that you are able to produce the last reaction.
So it's some
steady state subset of enzymes which carries flux. It will just become clearer when you look at the example. So let's look at this example, right? So what is an elementary flux mode? So you have P1, S4, P2, but this is not an elementary mode because P1 produces S1 and S4, right? So there is a reaction where S and S2 produces P2, which comes from S1. So this together becomes the elementary mode, right? Whatever is, so this reaction produces something, and you know, you, these two metabolites are used up in this reaction to finally form this product. So you have three reactions in this elementary mode. You have P1 giving S1 plus S4, S1 giving S2, and S2 plus S4 giving P2, right? This is also an elementary mode where P1 gives S1 plus S4, S1 plus P3 gives S3 plus P4, S3 gives S2, S2 gives P2. This is not an elementary mode because there are two subsets of enzymes that can carry steady state flux. The two indicated at the bottom, right? You can decompose this mode, flux mode, in terms of these two elementary flux modes.
P1 to P2, the same S4
path is
present in both the elementary flux.
P1 to?
P1 gives S4, S4 gives
P2, again P1 gives S4. S4 doesn't give P2, it's S4 plus S2 giving P2, right? See, this is how the reactions get written in a biochemistry textbook, right? So it can be a little confusing, but you have to immediately catch that. So P1 is S1 plus S4, S2 plus S4 gives P2, that's the next reaction. So it is basically some sort of one in to another, right? Which means like from one input to one output. It doesn't have to be, your biomass is never a single output, right? Your biomass is like several outputs. But you can think of a particular input to a particular output as an EFM. Let's look at one more example. Let's consider this example wherein we have pyruvate, PEP and OAA. So let's consider this simple set of reactions. What are all the elementary flux modes? So what is an elementary flux mode again? It can carry steady state flux with all irreversible reactions going in the correct direction. So here there are three irreversible reactions and three reversible reactions, right? So now how would you compute the elementary flux modes? How would you identify the elementary flux modes? So you can think of it as it has to start, let's start at PEP. So it can start at PEP and go in this direction, that will become an elementary flux mode. Or it can start at PEP, go to pyruvate and then go here, right? So both the irreversible reactions are in the correct way, right? And you can have similar for the other two. So you can have something that goes like this, something that goes like this, and something that goes like this, and something that goes like. There are six EFMs, every start and every end, right? You can identify if there is an EFM beginning at any particular reaction and going all the way up to any other reaction.
See, in the E. coli network you showed us yesterday, there was that there were those two pathways that were on.
So they won't be part of the same EFM. So synthetic lethals would never be part of the same EFM, right? Because an EFM is minimal in the sense you turn off anything in an EFM, there will be no more flux through the system. To the EFM, assuming that the EFM itself is essential. See, let's say
let's say this is biomass and there is some other non-essential pathway that's going on. This is still likely an EFM, but it won't even be lethal. If this is not produced, maybe nothing happens to the cell. But these may be essential EFMs. Right? And if you remove anything in these EFMs, it will be lethal.
So in the case of a cell like this, an EFM should be defined as any pathway that starts from outside.
Yeah.
That starts from
so some source to some sink.
So it can't just be a networking.
No, cell. No. Because it has to be functional under steady state. So it can't just like stop somewhere here, right? It has to go all the way. Because no steady state can stop within the cell, right? It all starts at your carbon source or something like that. You can look at smaller EFMs, they do make sense, but in general this is how one likes to look at EFMs. You can look at smaller EFMs. For example, one very interesting application of EFMs is that can lipids be produced from sugars? The opposite of this is the diabetic's nightmare, right? So all excess sugar in the body goes to lipids and so on and causes lots of issues, right? Can you actually produce lipids from sugars? I wrote it the other way around. Can sugars be produced from lipids? We know very well that lipids can be produced from sugars. Can sugars be produced from lipids? If so, then you know that can be used. In fact, you find that this happens in a lot of plants and all that. No, this involves the glyoxylate shunt and things like that. And it turns out that you can identify this very nicely using EFMs. So, is there an independent pathway which goes from sugars, from lipids to sugars?
So, EFM is something like independent pathways.
Yeah. So, they are systemically independent, right? I mean, so there is no... It doesn't rely on anything else to function.
So it's like IJK vectors, like everything.
Something like that.
But that is the extreme pathways.
So the one difference between EFM and extreme pathway is that EFM can be, you know, could be decomposed, right? In terms of, so if you see this example, there are only three extreme pathways. These are the only extreme pathways, because you add these two, you get this EFM, right? So EFMs can be broken down in terms of linear combinations of extreme pathways, but an extreme pathway itself can never be broken down further into, you know, linear combinations or anything like that. So this plus this will actually give you this, right? So, linear combination of extreme pathways will give you EFMs. Extreme pathways are simpler, EFMs can be a little more complex. So, even here, if you remove, this reaction is not there, right? So, you will just have pyruvate accumulating. You need 1, 2, 3 reactions in any EFM. So, if you only had 1, 2, 3, if you had these 4 reactions in the EFM and you deleted any of these reactions, that's going to be an accumulation, right? It can't work in steady state.
Same as extreme pathway, but if you take a combination of the extreme pathways, if you remove it, like you remove the say your combination.
So you can't remove a if you remove a reaction from an extreme pathway, an extreme pathway also won't function.
Exactly. So if you take an elementary flux mode, which is a combination of extreme pathways, and
right.
Remove a reaction, you'll still have one proper flux here, no? Because I mean that's an extreme pathway.
No, but it won't be, no, like for what is your example? So, you are looking at this plus this, right?
Remove those.
So, this goes out because of that. This reaction is no longer there, right? The pyruvate going out is no longer part of the extreme pathway. The extreme pathway is it's this, this, this and this.
The
elementary flux mode. So, this is one extreme pathway, this is another extreme pathway. The elementary flux mode is going to be this. You can't remove anything from that. because pyruvate will accumulate or oxalic acetate will accumulate. If you remove this, oxalic acetate accumulates. If you remove this, pyruvate will accumulate. You need this reaction which goes out, which is no longer there in the extreme pathway. This reaction is not part of the elementary flux mode, right? When you add these two extreme pathways, this reaction no longer exists. So in general, extreme pathways are simpler, right? Because linear combinations of them could be an elementary flux mode.
So in today's video, I hope you got a good introduction to the concept of elementary modes and extreme pathways. These are, you know, fundamentally connected with the flux space that is given by the stoichiometric matrix. And we looked at some definitions and also some simple examples. In the next video, we'll look at a slightly more complex example to understand to fixate these concepts of elementary modes and extreme pathways.